Sunday Assembly Sacramento. Today we're celebrating a really cool holiday. Who knows what that is?
Darling Day!
Yeah, now it also happens to be Valentine's Day in a couple days, and so Valentine's Day is pretty awesome too. But today is, in a sense, about Darwin, Charles Darwin, and evolution and all that. And I'm going to give more information later, but a show of hands right now. How many people are going to Darwin Day Carmichael right after Sunday Assembly? Big hands up. Fantastic. If your hands aren't up yet, I'll talk more about that in just a little bit, because it's going to be a really awesome event. If you have cell phones, please turn them off. I don't know if I... Yep, good, got mine. Cell phones off. Exits are on both sides of the building. There's two families here. Go out that way. You can grab your kids on the way out. Sunday Assembly is a secular congregation. We're here to celebrate life, to live better, wonder more, and help often. And we are radically inclusive. We are here to respect all people, all ideas, just to have a good time, to learn a little bit about science and the community and how we can make a difference in others' lives. There are so many people making a difference here at Sunday Assembly, and I wanted to just thank them real quick. All the way in the back running child care right now is Becky. Let's applaud so loud. And there were so many people helping this morning. I know that Nancy was there, Alan was there, Thomas was there, and then I lost track. And so who else was here helping out this morning? Thank you all. We got people running all kinds of different events throughout the months. We got people who've donated online and in person. Normally Matt is here with photography, he couldn't be here today, but we got Thomas running videography, so thanks to them. And thanks to the Reason Center, this facility, for allowing us yet again for 2.5 years now to have a home, to store our stuff, to offer coffee and donuts to everybody at a very small cost. And so I just want to remind you guys, if you ever need a place to do an event, this is the place to do it. It is the secular home in Sacramento, and any kind of event, birthday parties, work stuff. We've had a wedding here last year, so that was pretty cool too. How many of you guys are new to Sunday Assembly? Let me see some really big hands, because I want to count. Like, right up high, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Thank you all for coming. Round of applause. We are making this program grow. Like I said, we've been doing this for 2.5 years. We're still trying to figure out what's great and what isn't, but how cool that we filled up all these chairs, and there are more chairs to go. So maybe next month, come back, bring some friends with you, and tell us what we could do to make this a better program. Like I said, today is about evolution, of course. It's our annual kind of thing. Our theme is playing with a full deck. The main speaker, I'm happy to officially introduce in a few minutes, but you'll hear from Dr. Sarah Strand talk about evolution and play. We've also got a video, and if someone will do a little reading for us, a quick little passage from Mr. Darwin's book, and then a really neat video that if you were on Facebook today, this morning, you saw. We've got Ian, who is a student from Laguna Creek High School, who started his own Secular Student Alliance chapter. And so we've asked him to come in and share with us his experiences on that. Of course, we've got announcements, we've got our potluck and social hour following that, and then we're all going to head over to Carmichael and enjoy Darwin Day over there. So, all kinds of stuff going on. Normally we have this kind of done in advance, but who is willing to come up here and read just like 3 sentences from the end of this book? Would you?
Yeah.
Come on up. Round of applause. You are going to start from the word there, and the mic is yours.
There is a grandeur.
Grandeur.
Grandeur in this view of life, with its several powers having been originally breathed into a few forms or into one, and that while this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed law of gravity. From so simple a beginning, endless forms most beautiful and most wonderful have been and are being evolved.
Thank you so much. Appreciate that. I guess you could have had that slide up there too. What's cool about this particular... This is the end of this. That's the very last sentence on the Origin of Species. What's really neat about this particular sentence, if you look closely at this area, let me go back one. My fault. Okay, now it's getting real slow. Hold on. Pause. Sometimes it does this. Sometimes it just like goes super slow on me. Okay, we're getting back to Charles. There we go. Okay. Let's try that again. Hopefully it works okay for you. We'll see. So this area right over here, you can see that it says originally breathed into a few forms or into one. And that was the original words. When they asked him to re-release the book a couple years later, they changed it, or they had him change it, and they made him add the word from our Creator, with a capital C. They were like, you really need to do this, it's going to sell more. People are a little bit upset about your book, Mr. Darwin. Please edit your last sentence, and at least somewhere in this tome, reference your creator. And he did. He re-released it with that couple of extra words, kind of like when we added under God in our Pledge of Allegiance. But then in 1863, he wrote, I have long regretted that I troubled to public opinion and used that term of creation, by which I originally meant appeared by some wholly unknown process. It's mere rubbish thinking at present of origin of life. One might as well think of origin of matter. And so even then, it shows that as a religious person, he was still coming to grips with what he discovered or came to light, and how public pressure forced him to change that, and how he regretted that ever since. So, those of you who were at Freethought Day, I think it was 3 or 4 years ago, we had our main act was a gentleman named Baba Brinkman, a Canadian rapper. And he has since come out with a new song, and we're going to play that if this will work.
E-E-O-L-U-T-I-O-N, lies in your fairy tree, my broken whiskey of life, T-V-O-L, take a look, this deeper self.
Selection, natural, artificial, intellectual. I'm looking at Darwin, it gives a form of an organ, adaptive, or vestigial. Everything comes with a precedent, genetic and cultural replicants. Selection is when one of them is successful, attachment onto the next again. Selection. It's like clocking an extra dimension. It's like Neo perceiving the matrix, increasing your depth of perception. Selection, the region is awesome. From pollinators and trees when they blossom, from the dick of the finch to people who went from quiet to pure to walking. Selection, don't be afraid of it, life evolves, no one created it. The genome of every organism, nature is always mutating and changing it. Selection. It's a question of comprehension. Some people can see it and study it, others believe it's the devil's invention. Selection, the science is settled, every religious objection's been vetted and rejected. Selection is happening, the only question is in which direction. Selection. Embrace it for all of its benefits. It's paving the way for advances in everything from robotics to medicine. Selection at multiple levels. Genetic and cultural symbol selection selected your mental capacity to select and disseminate info. So tell me why rap is so cocky. Versace. Selection is sexual testicle. Bling! The signal is costly. Organisms are part of the tapestry, taking us back to abiogenesis, and every creature is really a relative, from trees to people to krill, and it's easy to see the resemblance, and when you spot it, say, geez, people are as selfish as they're taught to be. Altruism is often adapted, and that should be part of our public policies. Does freedom mean freedom to kill? Freedom to die in the street or to steal? Look for the tragedies of the commons, and when you see them, say, T-V-O-R. This new of life is adaptable, ready to follow wherever the facts go. Darwin just laid out the vision and showed how origins could be natural. He didn't spell out the map, though. There's so much more that we can reveal, and every new fact is in the scaffolding known as T-V-O-R. This new of life is exceptional. There isn't another one so successful at linking together so many domains in a way that's simple and algorithmical. Whenever selection and variations and heredity can be revealed as part of the system, Darwin is in effect. T-V-O-L. This new life is full of grandeur and majesty, but we lack the mastery of it to tackle the challenges facing humanity in this century. This new life is the only way to make sense of how people think and feel, so make it a mission to celebrate the vision. T-V-O-L.
Not bad, huh? If you want to watch that again or share that with your friends on social media, you'll find that on our Sunday Assembly page on Facebook. It was just posted this morning. So, speaking of evolution, I am thrilled to bring back to Sunday Assembly the Doctor, Sarah Strand. Those of you who were here 2 years ago for Valentine's Day may remember that she spoke about the neurobiology of love. Yeah, and so now we're switching it up, talking about neurobiology of play. Now, for those of you who don't know anything about Sarah, she teaches at Sacramento State University. She's a lecturer in psychology. She's also was the manager and supervisor of research at UC Davis. That's a was. Yeah. And she's been on Capital Public Radio, Fox 40, SAC News and Review. But I'm sure your best interview or your best presence ever was the one here, right?
Yes, of course.
Of course. So please welcome Dr. Sarah Strand.
Great introduction. One of the things that I love about giving this particular talk is it gives me a legitimate excuse to show as many pictures of cute animals playing. So you're gonna see a lot of those throughout the course of the talk today. And I'm also, as David said, gonna integrate how evolution contributes to this very widespread behavior of play, not just social play, but also other kinds of play. But we're going to talk a little bit more about how social play has evolved through a variety of different species. But one of the things that's always challenging when we talk about any behavior is figuring out what a good, complete, comprehensive definition of that particular behavior is. As with many behaviors that we observe, we often know it when we see it, but then when we try to describe what that is, it's a little bit more challenging. And so a definition that's been used pretty ubiquitously that was first coined by Beckhoff and Byers is the following. Play is all motor activity performed postnatally that appears to be purposeless in which motor patterns from other contexts may be used in modified forms or altered temporal sequences. That's pretty clunky. That's pretty clunky, but that's usually the kind of definition we get because we're trying to figure out a way to make it as comprehensive as possible. But as you can see, I've got my first set of cute individuals playing, and that highlights some of the different types of play that we often see. That first one, little girl on the left, is doing locomotor play. We've got a cat attacking a fuzzy toy, that's more predatory play. We've got a horse playing with a bucket, that's object play. And then we've got two little wolf pups playing, that's social play. So that isn't a comprehensive list of the types of play, but it is a pretty good cross-section of what we're going to talk about. And what I find most notable, and is probably why David asked me to talk today, is that play is not isolated to a single species, as you can see and as you will continue to see throughout the course of this talk. Play is something that we can observe in a variety of different species, and that enables us to ask evolutionary questions. Why is this behavior so ubiquitous among a wide swath of species, and how does it continue to be selected and passed along? And so one thing that Darwin laid out, you know, our good buddy Charlie, love his work, right? He laid out that there are two main ways that we can investigate how behaviors continue to be selected for and passed along through different species. And those are going to fall into two product categories: conditions of existence and common ancestry. So conditions of existence are sort of what that song was about, selective trait adaptation, what characteristics of our environment help us choose certain behaviors that then get passed on to future generations. But common ancestry, yeah, so it's not actually what I mean. Oh, there we go. Common ancestry talks more about how behaviors that were present in previous ancestors from, you know, centuries ago, thousands of years ago, first started showing those particular behaviors and how our environments might be similar to those common ancestors, which then basically made it possible for those behaviors to continue on. So I'm not going to be able to elucidate all of those, all the different aspects of conditions of existence or common ancestry today, but I can at least give you a few highlights. And so what we're going to talk about specifically and related to these different types of play when it comes to common ancestry, I'm going to talk about how species that play tend to have bigger brains. Okay, and that's not something that we can magically grow within the context of one generation. Usually that requires several ancestral species evolving bigger brains over time, and that those characteristics that contribute to a bigger brain will then enable us to pass those genes into the next generation. The first condition of existence that I'm going to talk about is how play strengthens social bonds. So we're going to talk specifically about social play in that context. And then also how play helps us perfect necessary skills that young individuals might need as they grow up and become adults and are interacting with their world and in a completely different manner. And then at the very end, I'm going to talk a little bit about how play in that context is similar to any video games or board games or anything like that that we might play to kind of bring it all back together. So let me start off talking about how play facilitates brain development. There is something called the social brain hypothesis. And I want to talk about this first before we get into brain development, because it's really important to understand this neocortex to whole brain ratio. So what we've got here, this is a picture of a brain. Hopefully you guys see that. This is a picture of a neocortex that has developed around the more primitive limbic system, reptilian complex, and old brain, or the hind brain. And it's called a neocortex, or new cortex, because it's the part of the brain that has evolved most recently. And so what scientists have discovered is that neocortex to whole brain ratio is bigger in primates that are social, and mammals that are social, as compared to non-social primates, as well as other mammals and other species. So there seems to be something really critical about the neocortex as it relates to social society, social structures. And scientists conclude that it's largely due to the complexity that we have as a social species. I mean, being a social species isn't just about having a bunch of people around you, right? It's about forming different kinds of relationships. When you're in a social species, you can't just rest on your laurels by knowing who individuals are. You have to know who stood by you when you were being bullied and who was the person that was bullying you. You have to know who stood by the bully when they were bullying you, and also who you can sort of reliably count on if you're needing to accomplish some hard task. So it's not so much about the quantity of relationships, but also the quality of relationships. I'll scratch your back and you scratch mine. And being able to distinguish individuals and relationships and hierarchies in that way requires a bit more brain power, requires a bit bigger neocortex. And so what's interesting as it relates to play is that social play, as a manifestation of that complex social environment, facilitates that brain development, facilitates bigger neocortices. So that's the social brain hypothesis. The other aspect of brain development is that what we see as scientists when we're studying the process of social play is that it is a dynamic process. I mean, think about it. When you are playing with somebody else, you don't know what they're going to do, right? You have to be flexible. You have to be able to react to unpredictability, to the unknown of what that person is going to do. And that ability to react enables you to learn flexibility, to be able to be react in unpredictable situations. And it gives young mammals and young species in particular practice at reacting to the unexpected. And what's interesting also is that play in those young species tend to peak around the time when the cerebellum is starting to develop. Now, the cerebellum, if I had to pick a favorite brain area, the cerebellum would be it. I mean, the cerebellum is all about movement and balance. I mean, it is the brain region that allows you to walk from one place to another without having to stare at your feet the whole time. Right? You know where your feet are. You don't have to stare at them the whole time. When you're walking down a flight of stairs, you don't have to look at your feet in order to walk down the stairs. You just kind of know. You look maybe once, and then your feet know where to go. That is the result of your cerebellum. It's a really, like I said, one of my favorite brain regions. But play helps the development of that cerebellum because you're needing to perform and react in dynamic ways and unpredictable ways. So play, that aspect of social play, really helps brain development. Okay, So, as it relates to evolution and that sort of concept of common ancestry, it seems that ancestral species with more complex social environments evolved bigger brains as a way to navigate that social complexity. What I've got behind me is a phylogenetic tree. This is one example of how not only physical traits, but behavioral traits are passed along through ancestral generations. What you've got there at the bottom here is the single common ancestor that produced all of those species that you see at the top of the tree. Each individual branch represents a species, right? But anywhere that you see a multiple branches, something like right here that differentiates the macaque species from the colobus species, that's going to be a node. So this here, this node, is the common ancestor for each of those individual species. These types of phylogenetic trees are used not just to figure out where physical characteristics originated, but also behavioral characteristics. You can map on the presence or absence of a particular behavioral characteristic onto this phylogenetic tree, and it helps us understand where these behaviors came from. So, in this particular example, we can at least propose that those who were more successful and perhaps had bigger brains survived and passed along those traits to subsequent related species. And as a result, as it includes play behavior, we can make a similar assumption. If complex social environments and playing in a social way enabled us to develop bigger brains, then that is something that's likely going to get passed around to future generations. So let's talk next about conditions of existence that may have led to the proliferation of play behavior. But before we do that, I want to get on the same page about what social play is in particular. And social play is essentially play involving another individual. That's about as concise a definition as you can get. But when it comes to figuring out how to identify play, we can use sort of two main characteristics. Clear signals are used to signal either let's play or let's continue to play, all right? So on the right here, we see a very classic, anybody know what the name of that behavior is?
Play-bow.
It's a play bow, exactly. This is a very classic kind of physical stance that a dog will take, and it's only ever displayed in a particular context where the dog wants to play. On the left-hand side, you might also recognize this as a play encounter, but it's a little bit more difficult to identify why exactly that is very clearly play. And what I can tell you is that the clear signals that indicate play are going to involve basically soft faces, soft expressions, and basically what's called a retraction of weapons, right? So what exactly does that mean? Well, the picture on the left is very clearly a retraction of weapons when you contrast it with the face on the right. The face on the right is not a play face, right? That is a killing face, right? The weapons are very clearly bared. Whereas in this picture, you've got a soft face, lips are covering the teeth. There's just kind of a very engaging kind of what we call a play face. Not a very descriptive, the term, but it's basically called a play face. So when you talk about social play, those are the kinds of characteristics you're going to look for. Sort of soft body language, soft expressions, and retraction of weapons from that particular encounter. And I'm going to point that out again in a couple of additional slides. So if we're going to talk about how play strengthens social bonds, then I want to at least review the brain opioid theory of attachment, which I briefly talked about, I talked about it more extensively in my talk 2 years ago. But I want to talk a little bit about it now, just so that we're on the same page about what we're talking about. So, the brain opioid theory of social attachment is based on evidence that people who have intense personal relationships show similar behaviors and emotional signs as people who are addicted to narcotics. Okay? So the same sorts of brain pathways that are engaged when you are in love are also engaged when you are addicted to drugs. And so what we're talking about here might not actually sound that unreasonable to some people. What we have here is a picture of the reward pathway. You've got the amygdala, the ventral tegmental area, the nucleus accumbens, and the nucleus arcuatus. And the red arrows indicate endorphin pathways, and then the blue arrows dopaminergic pathways, so pathways that are going to result in the release of dopamine. And what we see is that the brain opioid theory of attachment involves sort of three main phases. The first is that sort of euphoric addiction phase, right? When you are intensely in love with somebody, that's going to be associated with very intense feelings of interpersonal warmth and well-being and bliss, and also elevated levels of endorphins and dopamine, okay? After a period of time being around that person, you enter sort of the tolerance, aka habituation phase, where the same level of contact does not result in the same level of endorphins and dopamine. So you still enjoy being around that person, but in order to get that same high, then something has to change. Now, if you're talking about drugs, you take more of the drug in order to get that same high. If you're talking about a person, I don't know, maybe a polyamorous relationship, I'm not exactly sure, but eventually you reach a maximum where you can't really get the same level of euphoric addiction to that person anymore. But at that point, you enter a not less meaningful, but important phase called transitioning from attraction into attachment. And in that particular phase, you might not necessarily feel that same euphoria, but when you are away from that person, not for a few hours or a few days, but like weeks or months, when you're away from that person, you do legitimately go through withdrawal, and it's painful. If that person dies, if you break up, you will go through feelings of withdrawal. It's essentially like the drug that you were taking has very suddenly been taken away, and your neurons are starved for that endorphin or that dopamine. So if we think about neurochemically what our brains are doing when we're engaging in, you know, particular social behaviors, then it becomes reasonable to, then it becomes reasonable to start talking about how endorphins motivate and maintain our social relationships. They motivate and maintain them. And what we know as we discuss play is that endorphins, endorphins in general activate the reward pathway, and anything that activates the reward pathway is going to increase. So whether you're talking about social behaviors that activate the reward pathway will increase, whether you're talking about drug taking, whether you're talking about your favorite food that might activate the reward pathway, or maybe your favorite drink or something along those lines, anything that activates the reward pathway will increase that behavior again. And what scientists have shown is that endorphins increase in response to social play, but not non-social play. Okay? Endorphins increase in response to social play, but not non-social play. Specifically, endorphins are going to increase in the amygdala and the nucleus accumbens, which are, you know, very solidly situated within that reward pathway. And so one of the things that we can conclude is that endorphins increase in response to social play, but not non-social play, because we see that. But anybody who's taken an introductory statistics class has probably heard the sentence that I'm about to say. So who can complete this sentence for me? Correlation does not
imply causation.
There you go. Correlation does not imply causation. So if we're going to talk about how endorphins and social play interact, we can't necessarily say that endorphins cause social play or social play causes endorphins unless we run an experiment. So I'm going to do a little bit of neurochemistry here. Yeah, there's about a 4-second lag. So here's a very rudimentary picture of an agonist at work. An agonist is an analog of a hormone, a neurochemist, a neurotransmitter, or something along those lines that can bind to a receptor and activate the chain reaction following that particular receptor. So an agonist isn't the actual hormone or neurotransmitter, but it acts like it because it can bind to the receptor that then initiates a cascade. And then we also have antagonists, which that actually can block a receptor and prevent the chain reaction from happening. So we've got agonists that basically increase the chain reaction following binding of that receptor, and an antagonist that blocks the receptor. And what scientists have found is that endorphin agonists, so agonists that act like endorphins and bind to that receptor, do result in an increase in social play, rough and tumble play, whereas antagonists, when that receptor is blocked, that results in a decrease in social play. So once we know that, once we know that, that artificially either turning on or blocking those receptors has predictable results, then we can make the conclusion. Play increases endorphins. We're reasonably positive that that happens, and that social play serves to strengthen social bonds via an increase in endorphins, which activates that reward pathway. Okay? So at this point, we're fairly certain that social play does strengthen social bonds. But I want to also talk about non-social play. In this case, we're talking about social and non-social. Play also promotes skill acquisition, okay? Insects, reptiles, amphibians, and fish are born with rather fixed instincts that don't particularly need much practice in order to facilitate survival and reproduction. But more sophisticated species, mammals, non-human primates, definitely do have skills that require practice. And play tends to occur in species with the greatest need to practice those instinctual behaviors. Ergo, mammals play more than non-mammals, young mammals play more than adult mammals, and carnivores play more than herbivores. This is just basic observational behaviors that we can see. Primates play the most, and many scientists have suggested that primates are the most flexible species. They can survive and adapt to virtually any environment. Humans are a great example. Rhesus monkeys are another great example. They can basically, they're often referred to as the weed macaque because they can survive practically anywhere. Let's talk about what kinds of play facilitate skill acquisition. We've got physical play, that's going to be the chasing, wrestling, play fighting, those kinds of things which build strong bodies, and coordinated movement, help us figure out how to interact in unpredictable situations. We've also got constructive play, which promotes tool and shelter building, and basically, if you're talking about humans, you know, I've got a picture there of some toddlers playing with, you know, Lego bricks and blocks. That helps us practice how to build structures, shelters. This picture, I had a really hard time finding an example picture of infant non-humans using tools in play. I've seen it with my eyes a million times, but finding a picture of it was more challenging. And so you probably can't see this, but this little capuchin here is using a stick to pick her nose. She's using a stick to pick her nose. So I would classify that. Maybe that's more grooming than play, but in order to be able to figure out that that is a tool that you can use to perform that task, you had to have some access to it and play with it. And there's some wonderful data that backs that up with respect to tool use in rhesus macaques too, which I don't have time to go into now. So we've got physical play, we've got constructive play. We've also got, you know, we've talked about social play already, but the social play, in addition to being able to help us interact with individuals, react to unpredictable situation, this sort of pretend or dramatic play that you often see in humans also enables us to learn how to cooperate with others and control our impulses around others. It might not feel obvious at first with a, you know, 2-year-old or a 3-year-old that you are not supposed to hit somebody on the head with your toy truck. But over the course of doing that a few times, you learn that's not an actual adaptive strategy if you want to play with that person again. So you start to learn a little bit about impulse control through those kinds of pretend and dramatic play. You also find the proliferation of things called fantasy play, which does actually exercise our capacity for imagination. It enables us to practice thinking about things that aren't immediately in front of us. It starts to help us envision situations and scenarios that we have to think about and reason about, even if they're not right there in front of us. So we've got social play in terms of pretend and dramatic play, and you've also got fantasy play. Now I'm probably running out of time, so I wanna talk about two more things really quickly. How play is similar to games, and we can, when we talk about video games and board games and things like that, we can actually assess these things using similar metrics that we used with the other types of play that we talked about. So in terms of brain development, scientists investigating the effect of video games on brain development actually showed that there was an improvement in attention, multitasking, and visual acuity. All of those things relate to how our brains develop. Now, this is on a spectrum, right? It's not like more video game playing equals greater multitasking and attention and visual acuity. There is kind of a point of diminishing returns as it comes to this, but we can still talk about how it doesn't have to be no video games, that you know, some video games actually do improve brain development in that way. Families that play games together enjoy greater communication and a sense of cohesion, whether you're talking about board games or video games. And what's even more interesting is that those kind of cooperative, pro-social games, the thing that comes to mind is Pandemic. Have you guys ever played Pandemic? Right, those games where you're working together and you're sort of working together to accomplish a common goal does lead to the performance of greater pro-social behaviors in real life. Okay, so board games can actually strengthen social bonds, and other kinds of games can strengthen social bonds. And then as it relates to skill acquisition, I love this little picture. As it relates to skill acquisition, this one might not seem as obvious, but when you think about our current modern world, the physical world that we live in now is very, very different than what our ancestors evolved into. There are things like strategic thinking and plan formulation and problem solving and adapting to new situations and change in a very different sort of mental way than we really have ever had to accomplish before. And so playing video games that practice those skills, modern video games tend to encourage strategic thinking, plan formulation and execution, coordinating with people across the globe to accomplish certain tasks, and adapting to change. These are skills which do increase the probability for success in our modern, ever-changing, and competitive world. So, in summary, we can definitely conclude that play is an integral aspect of evolution and development. We've got conditions of existence and common ancestry. Play does tend to build bigger brains, more adaptive brains. It also helps strengthen social bonds and helps us develop certain skills. When we're talking about modern play that is more inclusive of video games, we can make similar conclusions. It does help promote brain development, it does facilitate social bonds, and it does help us develop modern survival skills. So thank you, Charlie, for giving us the framework to evaluate these behaviors. And thank you all for listening with rapt attention. And there you go.
And like a true scientist, Sarah has just a list of references. There's a dozen of them, a bibliography on a thesis,
yeah,
right here on the screen.
Well, you can't, in case anybody wanted to read
so
that.
So if we question you, you can number two, Beckhoff and Allen, 1997. Round of applause for Sarah. And speaking of games, although we didn't bring any video games today, if you stick around for our potluck and social hour, we're going to bring out a number of board games. We've got Jenga, we've got Connect Four, we've got Exploding Kittens, and other things.
Strengthen your social bonds!
Exactly! just go with it, yeah. Exploding Kittens?
Oh my god!
So we have another song. We're going to do an old song made new again back in the 80s. Get up on your feet, and this time, let's make use of the clapping and develop some of the endorphin things
yes.
that Sarah was talking about.
It's the endorphin things.
Yes.
Endorphin things.
It's a scientific thing. It's coming.
We need more volume. Everybody's gonna hear me.
Oh, louder, louder.
Come on, say you can't hurry, no. Some of those you just have to wait. Because of some of these days, it's a game of give and take. You can't hurry, no. Some of those you just have to wait. Just a little bit of time. I'm
His jaw dropped. What? You don't know about Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior?
Why not?
I didn't see him much after that or his family, and he started to avoid me at school. And so it kind of hurt, you know, being a little kid and just having people turn on you. So I was raised in a secular family. My parents wanted me to accept or reject religion at my own volition and find my own path instead of being told or forced what to believe. And they exposed me to a lot of religions, believe me, they tried. So we celebrated Hanukkah once or twice. We celebrate Christmas every year non-religiously. I went to Sunday school with some of my extended family and some of my friends if they invited me. I even stayed over with Muslim friends during Ramadan where I had some of the best chicken I've ever had. And for a couple of years, our family's favorite TV show was a Canadian sitcom, Little Mosque on the Prairie. Highly recommend it. It's very, very good. After observing and experiencing all these different religions and their customs, I ended up rejecting all of them, pretty much universally. So whenever friends, peers, or teachers asked if I believed in God or went to church, I simply said no, only to have them turn against me in disapproval, like with my Mormon friend from all those years ago. With this rejection lingering in my mind, I started to do some research in middle school. I found out I was considered an atheist, someone who simply lacks a belief in a God or gods, and that I was not alone. I didn't really consider my atheism to be that big of a deal, you know, just one of your parts of life. Go to school, do work, go to church, not go to church. Just, it didn't seem like a big deal to me, but I was so wrong. As I started to pay attention, I noticed more and more discrimination against atheists, from the comedic baby eater stereotype and the delicious, to the gruesome lack of human rights given to atheists around the world. I found out I couldn't even run for public office legally in a couple states. A good family friend of ours, who said she's not here today, told me about Free Thought Day at the beginning of my sophomore year in 2014. And attending Free Thought Day changed my whole world. I realized I could make a difference at my high school by starting a Secular Student Alliance chapter, a national organization that supports and protects the rights of atheist, agnostic, and otherwise non-religious students. And so my school had all these other religious clubs, Muslim Student Association, the Christian Club, and whatnot. They didn't have a non-religious club for students like me. And so I worked with the regional coordinator, Damon, shout out to you for helping with all this, who told me that it might be a challenge and that there were no other high school chapters in Northern California, but that he would support me regardless. So I worked with some SSA representatives from UC Davis, UNR, and even Sac State and Sac City on how to run my club, and I was really excited. Unfortunately, I got quite a bit of pushback from well-meaning friends and family. They were a little bit concerned that starting an atheist club would be too controversial and a little dangerous. It would isolate me from the mainstream, they said. It could be a little dangerous, they said. My godfather, an ironic title at this point, even suggested that it might be tough with some teachers, and believe me, my AP physics teacher of all people, oh god. And it might be a challenge to get into college or even get some scholarships, which on the contrary, I just landed a near full ride at UNBC thanks to my club. And one of my teachers, who's also an atheist, spoke out and shared his fears about the repercussions of starting my club, both academically and socially. So they meant well, but they were a bit worried. Nonetheless, I persevered. In my junior year, I filled out the necessary paperwork and turned it into our school administration and student government. And I was completely shocked. Our club was immediately approved with no questions asked. And I had been ready for a fight with, you know, the First Amendment and all that. However, the pushback would come sooner rather than later, or later rather than sooner, not from admin, but from other students. So when some of us went to a table at our club rush event where people could get information and sign up for our club, we were harassed quite extensively by the Christian clubs during our second lunch. They kind of surrounded our table with about maybe like 15 people, prevented people from signing up. They harassed us, told us we were going to hell, derogatory terms, the whole nine yards. And security didn't really do much, at least not at first, and you know, kind of expected that. But despite this, we had over 40 students sign up for our club, and other students and teachers thanked us for starting an SSA group so that their voices could be heard, and they felt like for once they were actually represented at this school. And some teachers even came out to me saying like, hey, thank you so much for doing this. I'm an atheist and I've always been scared to share my beliefs, but now that you're here, I feel safer. You know, like, so that meant a lot to me. And some teachers even gave me suggested reading lists. In our first 2 years, we had about 8 very thoroughly active members, and then we also had some speakers from the community to share their wisdom and support. At weekly meetings, we would either have a speaker or discuss current events, secular issues, videos, podcasts, and all that. And we did a couple other off-campus events, like David said, at Free Thought Day in 2015 and 16, where we were very well received, as we were the only high school representative, so I'm still kind of proud of that. And on campus, we had a Darwin Day over the last 2 years, and in fact, last Friday, we handed out over 28 dozen cupcakes to students during both lunches and literature about Darwin and evolution and information about our club. And so that felt pretty good to be very well received by people of all faiths, you know, give them a cupcake. Last year we held a movie screening of Chris Johnson's A Better Life, an exploration of meaning and joy in a world without God, that's a mouthful, on campus, and he was here at Free Thought Day 2 years ago, so some of you may have seen the film. If you haven't, I highly recommend it. It's a very, very beautiful, very good film, along with the coffee table book that goes with it. The movie screening is something that's really special to me because of the amount of time and planning, logistical challenges it presented. The filmmaker Chris Johnson is an international public figure in the atheist movement who has screened the movie to audiences all over the world, and after I met him at the aforementioned Free Thought Day in 2015, I knew I had to bring him back to Sacramento so that he could present to our club and show our movie and I could share it with more people. And so I worked with him on all the logistics over several months in emails and secured the venue, set it up, advertised to the school in the Sacramento region, coordinated with David and other atheist groups and HAGSA. And the screening had about 20, 30 people, including fellow students, parents, teachers, and other members of the atheist community. I was really proud. I was able to somehow pull this off. And it was a huge success, and to this day, Chris has still never done another screening at a high school, and he was really impressed by how well it actually fell together, and we're still in touch. Finally, as part of the International Baccalaureate Diploma Program, is writing an extended essay on any sort of research subject that we want. It's a 4,000-word college-level research paper on, and it has to be a question. Just answer a question of your choice. So I chose to do mine on the horrific treatment of atheists and lack of international action to protect them in the modern Middle East. And it was very disturbing, nonetheless, and it made me realize just how important being active in and supporting our community is all over the world. And with that, I will continue my activism in the atheist community and fight for equality and equal treatment when I attend UMBC as an international student. Thank you.
Ian, that was wonderful. Thank you so much. Congratulations on all of your successes.
Thank you.
Despite you going to Canada, we hope that you come back frequently and soon.
Back.
I'm sure your mom does too.
Awesome.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And it's my understanding that you've done what few other SSA affiliates have been able to do, plan your succession.
Yeah, we have a new president already lined up. We have events and other things are planned out. So
the next semester.
Yeah, the next semester, next year. So hopefully it lasts long after I'm gone.
I hope so.
That's the goal.
That's great. One more time for Ian Garvey. Time for us to reflect on evolution, on Charles Darwin, on Ian's accomplishments and the Secular Student Alliance, and of course on Sarah's presentation about the evolution of play, or the neurobiology of play. And so let's go to silent for a little bit. We'll bring up a little bit of background noise and just ponder, just think. Or check your phone, whatever. So now is the point where we have our open for all kinds of announcements. I've got a few. I'm sure you guys have some as well. But I'll start, because I'm already here. We've done a couple of these. We've got the Wine and Chat coming up again. I'll give you the date in just a second. We've done the Pizza and Possibilities. I hope that continues to happen. I would love to see more. And so everyone in this group and everyone that's not here today, you are all empowered to take one of these and make it your thing. On a monthly basis or whenever you want. If you want to start one of these smoops, that's a small group, go for it. Or anything else that's not even mentioned here. We will make it happen. We would love to see our community grow, and we empower you to be that person that starts this event or continues it. We'll help you get going. Come talk to any of the board members. Board members, raise your hand. There's one. That's right. There's only three right now. If you want to be on board, by the way, talk to one of those board members too. But we do have all kinds of really great events. This afternoon is Darwin Day. It's actually his birthday on February 12th. And so the speaker today is a gentleman who's going to be talking about climate change. A little bit different from the Darwin Day agenda, but still very important, especially with today's political climate. In case you haven't heard, climate change is a real thing. And so we're going to learn more about that through today's Darwin Day event. It's a great event. It's only for, I think, about 2.5 hours, 2 hours or so. It happens at 2 o'clock. Doors open at 2. The program starts at 2:30. And so if you leave here at around 1:45, that should give you plenty of time to get there. It's like $15 or $10. We sing Happy Birthday to Charles Darwin. There's cake. There's community groups. All kinds of different local organizations, scientific groups as well. Sunday Assembly will have a table there. And so it's in Carmichael. You can look it up on our Meetup page, and or you come see me after. I'll give you the directions and all that. Tomorrow in Placer County, the PFLAG has a really great talk also about evolution. They're going to be talking about same-sex love and how it naturally appears in nature. That's redundant, but you get what I'm saying. And so Sierra College professor Keely Kara will be giving that presentation. So if you're looking for a little bit more about evolution and want to see how same-sex love happens in nature outside of the human race, go for it. It's up in Placer County, a bit of a drive, but I'm pretty sure it's going to be worth it. It's in the evening at 7 p.m. In Placer. We've got book club. Misquoting Jesus is Sac Fan's book club this month. And this is really neat. KVIE is having, I think it's maybe their first nerd night, which is going to be trivia and all kinds of really cool stuff. And so you can find that on Sacramento Core's website. Of course, here we've got, well, not here in the building, but at Sacramento, Sunday Assembly, we've got our wine and chit chat. Who's hosting that? Ken? You're hosting that, right?
Yep.
Thank you so much. Is that at your home?
At our home again. In looking forward to just, you don't have to bring wine if you don't want to, or you just bring a favorite beverage, and we just hang out and talk and just get to know each other better.
Cool. So kind of that social bonding stuff at Sarah's.
Yeah, social bonding. Yeah, we get
awesome.
Liquored up, you know.
It helps.
Yeah,
it's much faster with
yeah.
We don't need evidence.
We don't get liquored up, by the way. And just bring a little snack, you know, something to share is all with it. We just hang out.
Yeah. And March 11th, about a month from now, AOF, Atheists and Other Freethinkers, they have their roughly quarterly highway cleanup up Highway 5 by Elkhorn Highway or Boulevard. And not on the calendar, but on our calendar, I'm turning 40 in like a week. And so you are all invited, I know, shocking. You are all invited to my birthday party. It's going to be in Lodi, downtown Lodi, at the World of Wonders Science Museum. You guys seem to like props. So World of Wonders Science Museum, downtown Lodi. They're having a huge expansion. They are planning and fundraising for it. And so I figured, hey, let's kind of combine the two events. It'll be 10 years since I helped that organization get started. And so I'm coming back to give them a little bit more push to get this giant project underway. And I know Lodi is not that close for a lot of you. It's right in my backyard. Imagine, though, in the Central Valley, a planetarium, a observatory, a small one, a 5-story building in downtown Lodi with a beautiful restaurant on top and science all the way down, that's right, 5-story, a carousel, and an entire community plaza in a side area of downtown Lodi that has been pretty much ignored, neglected, and
this sat there for a long time. So if you love science, and I know you do, it's a really cool cause. Ask me more about it during the potluck, and the event is up on our meetup page. So all kinds of really cool things, and all, if not most of these, are up here on sacramentocore.org. If they're not already on our meetup, they're definitely on that one. But again, you guys are empowered to create these kinds of events yourself, should you choose to do it. There are all, it's super easy to do. Just go online and click on the I want to make a new button, or I want to make a new event, new button. Click on the button that says schedule a meetup. You know what I'm saying. And make it happen. Whatever kind of event it is, just fill out the information, and or come talk to us, and we'll do it for you. So that was all of my announcements. Open floor, let's start with Tim.
Yeah,
if you have anything, just stand up after him.
Really, the three things, the wine chat, we really look forward to meeting new folks there at our house, it's hosting all that. Two other things is I've been involved with the American River Parkway Association for a number of years, helping with cleanups, and I got a call from them and looking to, they want to know if I'd be interested in adopting a section of the river to clean up. So I said yes. They're waiting to see what's going to open up, and I wanted, if you would be interested in participating in cleaning up a specific, it's kind of like the highway cleanup section of the river, let me know. Get in touch with me today, and I'll be posting stuff about that. And also, have you heard about the Science March on Washington? So that's coming up here in Sacramento. We're going to do it here in Sacramento on the 22nd of April. There's going to be something out on Facebook, and I'm just encouraging people to look for that, Google it, and sign up to volunteer and be involved in that on the 22nd.
Is that the same day as Earth Day?
It is, correct.
Excellent. Yeah. Very cool. I would love to see us show up there in force. Yeah. Jen, I saw your hand up.
Yeah. I'm coming to your party, bringing a friend,
Thank you.
I'm going to do wine tasting in Lodi before.
Good.
Because it's the Zinfandel capital.
It happens.
So, and you'll have less to have to serve me then. And I'll make a donation to the Science Museum, and I'm really looking forward to it. It's a great way to celebrate your birthday.
Good idea.
Back in the fall, I had mentioned, because things come up when we talk about and we recognize the importance of our voice, making it known to our government representatives, that I wanted to start a small, time-limited SMOOP about how to engage in the civil process. And my life hasn't quieted down yet for me to do it. And it was also hard to pick a day and know what would work for people. But in the meantime, if any of you went on the march on Washington, the women's march we had at our pink pussy hats and all that, if all those people just go home, it doesn't matter. And there is a website I just want to make you aware of. You don't need me. It's called indivisibleguide.com. And it does say on its website, a practical guide for resisting the Trump agenda. But I don't want to make an assumption about what anybody's political leanings is. And there are many people who feel like you don't resist. Could we just have conversations and try to move together? And I think that's all very important. So I don't want to set this up as a resist, an angry kind of thing. But just in general, it's a good, I read through it, it's an awesome thing about just understanding what you can do about any issue that matters to you, environmental. And then the third thing I wanted to say was that there is a sign-in sheet if you're brand new, and I would love it if you would sign in, because like last month, and every once in a while I try to be like the welcome committee, and I send emails to people who have signed in just to give you a little more information and stuff like that. It's just nice to have, and that's all I want to say. So sign in, please, if you can. Indivisibleguide.com. And if you just Google indivisible, it's all, a lot of people are talking about it.
That was indivisibleguide.com. Great.
You think high school's taught it, and they don't.
And speaking of that, I know a number of our folks here went to the Women's March on the Capitol. Raise your hand if you were there. Would any of you, maybe just one or two of you, care to come up and share what that experience was like? March on up here? Marie!
March on up here? I mean, obviously, anyone who was there, it was amazing. I haven't done a march of any kind for about 10 to 12 years. And we didn't obviously know what was going to show up, and it was just masses of humanity. I knew a lot of my friends were there, couldn't find them. So in a way that's fascinating, to go to a mass of humanity and look around and see masses of humanity that you don't know. I did go with a book club group, so we stayed pretty tight. The only other person I saw that I knew was one of my students at the Art Institute. But I talked to someone else who's a friend of mine who went just by herself with a friend, and I'm a big piece of mush at times anyway. I'm very stoic, and then I'm a big you know, Waller, I cried, everything. And I was standing there before it started, and I just started to tear up, and just for a few seconds, you know, I wasn't sobbing. But it was just that thing of seeing all these people there that had been galvanized, and you know, we're not supposed to get political in this Sunday Assembly, but I think today we are, which is great. So, as she said, the problem is, yes, 20,000 people were there for one day. Where do you go from here? You can't just think showing up for one day is going to make a change. So we have to find ways to continue to whatever. Resist is becoming like one of the key words, isn't it? Resistance, the resistance, like in WW2. So we have the resistance that is happening, and we're in California, so yay. Segueing in a very cheap way into what I was going to talk about anyway, I have made a CD. No, is that it? CD? Yeah, I always get my tech terms wrong. I'm a singer-songwriter, and I'm coming out with this stuff now, and I've just released it. I have a website, and I have a card. So there are cards on the table. I'm happy to give you one. I am singing songs that is jazz styling. A little tired of protest songs being folk songs. It's like, really, kumbaya, okay, yeah. So let's put some soul and beat behind it. So my stuff is, I call it eclectic jazz. My language is, I'm trying not to be preachy, but it is for our community, and it is for people who want to think and get past a lot of roadblocks that we've run into. And so in a way, I think it's kind of cool. Of course, it's my opinion. That I am showing up in this time and place with what I am doing, because I feel that what I am singing about is what we're trying to fight, to be blunt. So I am more than happy to give you a card, go online, it's mariebain.com. You can read the lyrics, you can sample the songs, you can buy them or not. I've got one video already on YouTube, thank you. And I have another one coming up that I think is hopefully going to make a big splash in about 2 to 3 weeks. We'll be releasing it. It's called Why Are You Here? And again, why are you here? Anyone got an answer? Because your parents had sex. Right? That is what my song is about, and that is what it leads to. Reality people. With some humor. Hopefully there's a little bit of humor. So, the march was fabulous. We've got to keep up the fight, and sitting in your house screaming at the TV doesn't do it. So, you know, let's join, let's do things, and keep going, because obviously we have 2 to 4 years of hell to continue to fight, and we got to do it in a lot of different ways. So those who were there, yay.
Or be smart like this kid and go to Canada.
Yeah.
And you know what? Yes, I was just reading something about you can cross the border much easier into Canada than from Mexico to here. So that's what's happening.
Alan, your hand went up.
Hi. So I'm the leasing agent from the Reason Center here. So if anybody is interested, hey, this looks like a good place for my little group or whoever to meet or have a birthday or whatever, I'm the person to talk to. I can help you make that happen. Also, I wanted to comment on the meetup page. You were saying that anybody has the ability to suggest a meetup group. Something I've noticed about the meetup website, a lot of people use the app on your phone. Those suggested meetups don't show up on your phone. You have to go online on the website on a desktop or laptop computer to be able to see those. And then once it gets 3 votes from 3 people who say they will go, then it shows up on the website on that phone app as a real thing that's going to happen. So if you're looking for stuff that other people have suggested, you have to use a computer, not just your phone app.
Right.
So hopefully, if you do suggest something, now people know how to find your thing and say that they want to go to it.
It also sends an email directly to myself and I think Eileen or somebody else, and you and John, and normally we approve them within seconds. So yeah. Before Nancy, I know that there were 2 other hands that went up over here. Oh, okay, yeah.
How, if you do that, you go to your computer and you make a suggested meetup, how do you let people know that you put it there?
What happens is, once the meetup is suggested by anybody, it sends an email to myself, John, and Eileen. We'll then double check it, correct any spelling mistakes, make sure it doesn't conflict with anything on the schedule, and then when one of us pushes the magic button, then it goes out to everybody.
Everybody sees it, but then so everybody just has to meet it. Once it goes out to everybody, then you'll see it on our phone?
Absolutely. Yeah, you can at that point.
You can see an email on your phone.
And also the event if you're on the meetup page.
Can you RSVP?
Yep.
Okay.
And that just becomes, at that point, it becomes like a regular event that, that any of us put in there. Yeah.
I'm sure many of you know about that already, but I found an app on my phone called Charity Miles, and it's hosted by Johnson & Johnson, and basically you go on a hike, you go on a walk, you run, I don't run. They donate 25 cents per mile, and you can do it indoor on a treadmill, you can do it outside with GPS, and you can also bike, and that's 10 cents a mile. And so if we're talking about helping often, it's a really easy way to do so. National Parks is on there. And I think there are probably about 20 or 25 different charities that you could choose from. There are some that are conspicuously not there, but it's really easy to do. I actually have it on right now. I should have my phone on me, so I'm tracking everything. But it's, you know, it's an easy way to help, and I think that I can show you after at the potluck if you're interested.
That's awesome. And there was one more hand.
Following up with action from the Women's March,
yes.
And like not just marching when you don't have tea. I don't want to get political, but if anybody wants to know more, we've joined Showing Up for Racial Justice, SACMAL, which is an amazing group that allies with other people of color led groups to be allies if they're white people, to use our privilege to help their advocacy and help them basically represent themselves. So if you want more information about that, ask any of us. And there's also a bunch of individual guided groups that are joining to enact some of the stuff that we're doing around. And we've gone to some of those. So if you have any questions, just find me.
Great. You guys will be around for the potluck?
Yeah.
And it was called Showing Up for Social Justice, Sacramento. Showing Up for Racial Justice,
Sacramento.
Got it. That's excellent. All right. Did I miss anybody? Yes.
Real quick. There's a very easy action that's starting to take a momentum now, and that is to simply, on March 15th, send a postcard with your thoughts to the White House. That could be your letter signs that you had at the Women's March. There's wonderful signs there. Or it could be a suggestion, or maybe how you plan to resist, or that you are resisting. It could be anything. And the idea is to try to get a million pieces of mail to down on the floor of the White House all at once, showing that there's momentum and stuff, I think. Pennies, send your postcard, March 15th.
Does that mean mail it, or if the goal is for it to get there?
Well, I don't think we can control that, you know,
so
because...
Drop it in the mail around the
15th. Drop it in the mail on the 15th, and okay. Hopefully a lot of it will get there within the next 2-3 days. Yeah.
All right, awesome. Thank you for all those announcements. Again, if you missed any or you want to follow up with anybody, just find them during the potluck. I want to thank again the speakers, Sarah and Ian and Charles Darwin and Bob and Brinkman for the video and everyone who helped set up and childcare and donations and all of that. Speaking of donations, a little bit in just a few minutes, we're going to pass the hat and you know what to do there. If you're capable of doing so, great. Our average monthly income last year was $96 per service. If we can bump that up a little bit, that would be awesome too. And you can also donate online. We are an official 501c3, which means that your donations are more than likely tax deductible, which is great for you, helps us out as well. And if you ever have any questions about our finances, there she is.
Oh.
There's Eileen, our new treasurer, and yeah. So what we're going to do now is we are going to have a little icebreaker. You guys are going to stand up, meet your neighbor, and I'll answer your question in just a second. You're going to stand up, you're going to meet your neighbor, maybe share what your favorite game is, and we'll pass the hats around that time. And then after that's done, stay standing for our final song before we move into the potluck. So I'm going to get some music, we'll get some hats going around, and then I'll take your question or whatever we do there. So stand up and introduce yourself.
Patrick.
Hi. Thank you.
Down and took her shoes off.